cursed by the old gods of Bethany. We are four souls destined to review the 1001
movies,
albums,
songs,
and TV shows you must consume before you die. Until then, we are the Immortals.
And this is episode 175.
We did it!
Yeah!
We did it? What did we do?
We did it all.
1 through 174.
Four. There you go.
It's true.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Again, you've heard Pedro do some simple counting on this podcast.
Indeed.
As we get to hear every week.
I'm Austin.
I'm Sarah.
Math magician. I'm JC.
And I'm a math magician.
You are.
Magician.
Wow, it's the first time I've never said my name.
Oh my god. Pedro, isn't it liberating?
It feels weird.
JC has said.
Does it get easier the second time, like murder?
Whoa. Pedro, welcome to the bit.
Edit,
yes.
Edit that out. The murder confession.
I would like you to know that this we're doing the 76th entry in these books that we do.
Mm-hmm.
Low, low, low entry.
Very low.
Yeah, very low. And the Pokemon number is also very low.
Ooh.
And it's Golem.
I like
which is, Golem. Golem's just a stupid boulder with stupid turtle hands and feet and a head. And there's a Hawaiian form that's that, but also a cannon that opens
what?
Up at the top and shoots cannonballs and is
no.
electric rock type. You haven't seen Alolan Golem?
No.
Alolan Golem
no.
is a phrase
that's
that is
Alolan cool. Golem.
I'm a sounds big like fan a of Geodude.
Like, it's fun.
The first
he's just
iteration.
Constantly showing his biceps.
Yeah, Geodude is baby Golem. See, it's Alolan Geodude. It's Alolan Golem. Huh. He's got a little
he's got a mustache
and a
mustache.
Yes, he also has a mustache and a beard. A lot of them have mustaches.
What? Is this the final? This is the final form.
No, yeah, this is Golem is the final form, but this is the Alolan final
yeah.
form, which is different. But their Alolan forms are weird.
Like how he thought he wanted an extra pair of arms when he turns into Graveler.
Yeah.
And then they're like, no, I don't need those, actually.
All of my Gravelers are named things like Handsy and Pervert, because they have too many hands.
Oh my god. Just a rolling ball of Pervert.
Pretty much. I like how Pokemon decided that they needed regional forms, because they realized that they were very quickly running out of, you know... Like,
Pokemon.
There are 802 Pokemon. Like, there are too many.
Yeah.
And they need to be able to have something new in a game while making the generation smaller. So they're just
I mean,
reworking
that's
previous
very
Pokemon.
Smart.
I mean, yeah.
And in the next one, we're going to have, like, everything is, like, Britain-themed. There are some fake Britain, I can't remember what it's called, Pokemon. And one of them is coughing. And it just turned it into a giant bong. Like, it's just a bong. I swear, it's just a bong.
That's not where I would have gone. I would have thought, oh, we went to, like, the tropics. Next, let's go to, like, the fucking North Pole.
No,
let's
yeah.
let's see the North Pole version
well, there's
of
been a,
some of these.
There's, yeah, there's been Hawaii, and then they've done... And then France was before Hawaii, and now we're doing Britain and everything.
What?
And so there's, like, a corgi one.
Is there a Cockney Pokemon?
I mean... I don't know what it would be, because Cockney is a noise, not an appearance, and Pokemon...
It is a noise. Thank
Pokemon
you, Sarah.
Don't talk. They just say their own name.
Yeah.
Except for Meowth in the anime, but we don't speak about that, because it's weird and doesn't make sense.
Fair.
Cats shouldn't talk.
That's accurate. We don't want to hear what they have to say. Did you hear
I
that,
don't.
Kitty? Did you hear that?
Wait.
The cat's staring at me.
Meow.
A talking
the
cat?
People who listen to this podcast have heard my cats have to say, like, a lot. Because
yeah, it's true.
They scream in the background, and I can't make them any quieter.
I know how that goes.
That's okay.
Should we podcast now?
Oh, great news. We have been recording for about 4 minutes now.
Well, that seems foolish.
What did we watch?
Well, wait. Real fast. The 76 criterion, because we're
right.
the 76 entries. We always look at the Pokemon and criterion for whatever reason. Spy number 76 for criterion is the wonderful David Lean film Brief Encounter. So it's very much in the mood for, like, Before Sunrise and In the Mood for Love. It's wonderful and British and very sweet. Great movie.
I feel like the Criterion things is kind of like Criterion Spines is cool and all, but it's kind of just a takeover of the dumb thing I thought of, but classier.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's 100% what's happening.
Yeah. I'm just saying, it was my idea first.
This was direct counter-programming. But no, JC brought up a good point. What are we talking about this episode? What are the 76 Movies, albums, songs, and TV shows we must all consume before we die.
We watched The Gold Diggers of 1933.
The album was Beach Samba by Astrud Gilberto.
The song was I Walk the Line
by...
God damn it. Johnny Cash. There we go.
Did you not know?
Wow.
Somehow Paul Newman kept coming into my head, and I'm like, it's not Paul Newman.
I thought you were waiting to do like a Johnny Cash or something, but no, you just
like
forgot.
Somehow the name just went away.
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash.
Oh, boy. Well.
Hey, Joe, that was horrible.
That was
It just went away for some reason. It came back.
I think you should worry about your brain.
Yeah. Yeah, no problem. Before we get into all that, anyone watch anything or listen to anything good?
Joker.
I also saw Joker, and I disagree that I watched anything good.
I have watched so many things since we last did this podcast, I don't even know myself anymore.
Whoa.
I just glanced at my letterbox. I'm like, oh yeah, I've seen like 10 films.
I've also seen a bunch of stuff, yeah.
I saw It Chapter 2, which I think we've all seen, right?
I have not seen it, but I'm good.
I liked it.
Thank you. Me too.
The first one I think is better, but it's still like a
No, I agree. I
can say that in a theater that I saw it in, somebody comically threw their whole like tub of popcorn into the air during a scare as though we were in a commercial.
I like that.
Was it intentional?
Yeah, it was not intentional. It was like they got scared and they went, whoa!
I thought you were going to say that someone got angry and like threw it at the screen and said, this sucks.
No, like, they were scared. It's a scary movie.
Yeah.
So we saw Joker. Can I read a quote from the A.O. Scott review of Joker?
Sure.
So I really did not like the movie. I know that other people really did like the movie. It has inspired a range of reviews that have been a lot of fun to read. And A.O. Scott really digs in. Including this. Joker is an empty, foggy exercise in secondhand style and second-rate philosophizing, besotted with the notion of its own audacity. As if willful unpleasantness were a form of artistic courage, the film turns out to be afraid of its own shadow, or at least of the faintest shadow of any actual relevance.
Boom.
Like, A.O. Scott does not mess around when A.O. Scott wants to burn a movie.
Wow, that is vicious.
I can say that I watched the trailer for The Joker for the first time when I went to go see It Chapter 2.
I thought it was I thought that it was a good it has good perform like Joaquin Phoenix is genuinely good. The movie is bad and bad for us.
I liked It Chapter 2 more than Joker in terms of villainous clowns.
Of course.
Yeah. Didn't really like the film though.
Well, I think I liked It Chapter 2 more than Joker, but I liked them both.
That's David good. Sims, who tweeted something that I thought was really funny, which is like, the Joker is the first movie to break like Robert De Niro's opening weekend record, which was previously held by Shark Tale.
Amazing.
Oh, boy.
I wonder what it was before that.
Amazing.
For Shark Tale?
Yeah.
Analyze this.
I think Shark Tale's probably
Meet the Parents.
Probably one of the Meet the Parents.
Yeah.
I would note that it is not called The Joker, guys.
It
never
is
forget.
Just
it's just Joker. Joker.
True.
Because it's edgy like that. It's bad. I could do a whole podcast about why it's bad, but I kind of already did that over lunch yesterday.
I saw Fleabag season 2.
Ah!
Hell yeah.
It's so good. It has an incredible ending. I do think that people who think that this season is like much better than the first season need to think about why they think that, which is because I think that's something that's come out since Phoebe Waller-Bridge won all her Emmys. It's like, this feels like everyone's a little late to the party, and I feel like people have some introspecting to do, but it's really good.
Do you think that people like the second season because there's a dude in it?
I do.
Yeah. I think they're both
amazing. I don't
think
that's, yeah.
I think they're, and I think that like his performance is fabulous. So I don't think there's anything wrong with liking the show because in part because his performance is fabulous. But I think the first season is much, I don't know. It's so raw and like, tightly put together and unabashedly female. Not that the second one season isn't unabashedly female. It's pretty damn female, but, I love that show. It's great. I do like the first season better.
I don't think that's the intention behind the like show. Like, it very much feels like you couldn't have the second season without the first.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it's very, like, it feels like this really comprehensive progression. And it's so, like, the whole thing together is just, like, really amazing. And then it's just interesting that, like, this is the season everybody was like, hot priest, let's do it. And I'm like, he's not that hot. I'm sorry. That's my hot take.
That is a hot take.
That is a hot take.
I'm sorry.
It is a take that I disagree with.
I think he's fine. I feel like I see a lot of stuff. I saw a lot of stuff before I watched it about, like, how hot their making out scenes were. And I was just like, I think it's good. I really like their chemistry. But I wasn't like, I don't know. It didn't fry my egg, as they say.
That's a gross phrase.
Do they say
in this like context, that. And I never want to hear it again.
My yolk. No, but it's really fucking good. Also, I started watching Dairy Girls, which is also really fucking good.
Yeah. Dairy Girls, so good.
But that's what I have to give.
Peter, have you seen all of Dairy Girls now?
Or just... I saw, I think, the first season.
Yeah,
which ends with them watching a news report.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's such a good show.
The main character's face is made of this weird plastic that I cannot disturb. Yes. I think it's alien.
Yeah. Sarah, you would like that show.
Yeah, I have heard.
Oh, Sarah, you would love Dairy Girls.
I know. It's on my list.
Let's just watch a bunch of horror things. I decided to watch all the Friday the 13th films.
Have you finished all of them?
I'm two and a half into them.
Oh. How's that been going for you?
I mean, they're dumb.
Shit, we are far into October at this point.
Episode comes out?
Yeah.
Yes.
And also today.
Which is not when this episode comes out.
I would argue the day this comes out is far in October. This is not.
25% into October is not a good amount of progress?
Yes.
It is a great amount of progress. I've only got 3 weeks whereas I had four.
God damn it. How am I the time tyrant
who time tyrant. Says
shit like that?
4 weeks is not a long time.
I've seen half of the third one. I paused it to do this. What are good horror films I've seen, though? I really enjoyed Blood and Black Lace. I watched that last night. That was really cool, really creepy. Italian film. I watched a really messed up Australian film called Wake and Fright, which is on the podcast list. Forgot it was. Started watching it, so that one crossed off.
You watched the real opening for Cinepocalypse, not the Glenn Danzig movie, but the...
The Beelzebub.
Yes.
That was good. I think you mentioned that when you went to Cinepocalypse. I enjoyed that quite a bit. Has kind of a crazier back half, but first half is, like, so good.
Very terrifying.
I heard that one is really good.
It has some really good, creepy scenes. Like, it has kind of a, like...
It has a really good range of creepy. It has, like, shock and awe, like, right at the get-go. And then it also has a lot of, like, simmer, a lot of suspense. Mm-hmm. Like, it's a good full package.
Good tarot reading scene. A good classic horror scene. Yeah.
Yeah.
I enjoy that quite a bit. And the more I keep thinking about it more, I think I keep liking it more. That's on Shudder. And so is actually the other two films I said.
And the director is a very, very nice guy. He was at all of Cinepocalypse. He come up to me and asked me what I thought about the most recent movie.
Oh yeah,
fairly often.
Cool.
Yeah.
Anyone have anything to say? Well, I guess, do you want to say more about Joker? You kind of said Joker laughed and then didn't say anything.
Well, I mean, I liked the experience, and the first maybe half of the film was good.
I agree.
The second half, things sort of started to unravel in strange ways.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I mean, it all. I guess it just depends on how you take it. I don't think the movie is trying to make him better, but maybe it is, and I just didn't get it. The movie didn't fool me. I don't know.
Super long time ago, but on this podcast, we did... So the only Scorsese we've done is The King of Comedy.
Yes.
Sarah and Pedro, that was your first time watching King of Comedy.
Yep.
And The King of Comedy is... It's hard to even say it, an influence on Joker, in that it's just The King of Comedy. Even the Robert De Niro's... talk show scenes are the exact same curtains as The King of Comedy.
Mm-hmm.
Did that...
Was it De Niro in King of Comedy?
I will read...
Okay.
And Taxi Driver.
I will read from David Ehrlich's review now on this topic. The Joker is also a toxic rallying cry for self-pitying incels, and a hyper-familiar origin story so indebted to Taxi Driver and The King of Comedy that Martin Scorsese probably deserves an executive producer credit.
Yeah.
Yeah. So...
It's crazy because you can intuit all of that just from the trailer.
It was exactly what I thought it would be, and like because of that, I was not. I will say, like, I actually liked it more than I thought I would because, like, I was like, I expected the performance to be equally sort of flat. Like, I don't think that any of the points that it's making are at all interesting, frankly. But actually, I think Joaquin Phoenix does a really amazing job at playing a, like, very sad, mentally ill man who is in, like, a very bad situation. And, like, there are, like, hints of the movie actually giving a shit about the mentally ill occasionally, which are then immediately stomped on and shit on. But, like, I think that Joaquin Phoenix's performance is very cool. I
would just recommend Joaquin Phoenix's previous film, You Were Never Really Here, as a much better Joker-akin movie.
Mm-hmm.
That was by Leanne Ramsey. Really good film from last year, 2 years ago. Really, really good of a veteran coming back and kind of hired to kind of bring back kidnapped women. And so you have kind of a mentally ill, set by violence, complicated character study. Dig that one more. That's Wayne's.
Important
that
to note that Todd Phillips has declared that you can't be funny anymore.
It's true.
Is that the director?
Did you all see that?
Yeah, yeah. I saw that.
He says in today,
where he's like, you have to be woke to, or like, what did it? What's the quote?
It's just impossible in today's. That's why he made Joker. Was that he just? It's impossible to make a comedy nowadays. And
he gives
us woke culture.
Is what he.
Yeah, you know. The dying cry of the straight cis white man comedian.
And also, like, we just named, like, several comedies this episode that are great.
That are fucking great.
Fleabag, Bad Girls. Yeah. Comedy's still around.
Yeah, it's going strong. It's, and it doesn't have a Netflix special. It's titled Triggered. So.
All right, let's get into some 30s entertainment.
Yeah.
Before woke culture.
Yeah, before woke culture. we made these beautiful movies like
Gold Diggers of 1933. Let's make a show. An incredible movie called Gold Diggers of 1933, which is directed by Mervyn LeRoy, who I don't fucking know who that is. I'm sure Austin will tell me. But it's actually based on a play, and there are a bunch of these. It's like a not a serial, but there's just a lot of different versions of this that have come out. It is
of this being Gold Diggers or of, like, plays?
There are multiple films called Gold Diggers of blank, at least, like, three.
Yeah.
It's akin to also, like, how there's the Broadway Melody in 1927, Broadway Melody in 1929. Essentially, they don't connect at all, except that they are musicals.
Okay. But with different songs. Each one has different songs.
Women.
Yeah.
Weird.
It's about a group of showgirls, and they all have these sort of, like, I can't remember their names, but they occupy these sort of tropes. Like, there's, like, the funny girl who's, like, a comedian. There's, like, a younger girl who's, like, sort of naive and, like, the love interest of everybody. Ginger Rogers plays this, like, has this sort of fun part where she is sort of, like, trying to get in everyone's business all the time and is actually trying to gold dig. But they have these sort of roles that they play. It's during the Great Depression. They're all living in an apartment together. A huge fucking apartment, let me just say.
Yep.
But I really like the film starts out. Once there's like a musical number that opens it. But once you get to them, there's one of the girls is like stealing the milk off of someone else's balcony.
Mm-hmm. Yup.
Which I was like, this is stealing someone else's Amazon package, but in 1933.
Well, no, it's sustenance during the Depression. It's a little more serious, I think.
I don't know. I've had people steal my takeout before when it's been like left outside or my Blue Apron box, and I figured they probably actually needed to eat it.
Yeah. I don't think, I mean, I don't know.
Stealing my Blue Apron box is, this is the stealing your Blue Apron box of 1933.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, also, you go through the self-checkout line and you, you know, you do what you need to do. These four women, they're showgirls, they're in Broadway, and this is a fun movie because Broadway is sort of this, like, seedy sort of underbelly place, like,
right.
Which is very fun. One of the girls is in love with this songwriter who lives across the street in another apartment building, and she watches them sing. And then this dude who's a producer comes in. Oh, his name is Barney. That's what his name is. And he's like, oh, I'm here and I've got a show for you girls, blah, 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 blah. And they all fucking lose their minds because they want to be in the show and make money because it's the Depression. And that's pretty much like the journey of the movie. Like, he ends up like listening to the songwriter guy and is like, why don't you write the song for the movie? They're trying to get money. And then like there's like the benefactor who pays for the show, which actually ends up being the songwriter because he's from a wealthy family.
Spoilers.
And then the whole sort of like the conflict of the movie, which really like we get to like an hour in, like it takes a long time for us to get there, is that the songwriter is from like this very wealthy family, and his brother and his brother's like business partner, I guess,
lawyer,
a friend,
their family estate lawyer. Mm-hmm.
Family estate lawyer. Thank you, Pedro.
Yep.
Come to get him because they're like, you're too good to marry a showgirl. And then two of the girls are like, oh, hello. Won't you buy my hat for me? And they're like, fine, I will. And then they all sort of become romantically entangled. And the show, and that's how, and that's why it's called Gold Diggers of 1933.
Well,
that's it.
That's good.
I think they're gold diggers. They accuse them flat out. Like, oh,
I don't think they're gold diggers either, really.
Yeah.
No, only one, but even then she wasn't.
The one with the lawyer, because like, the lawyer's like way older.
She was having legit fun, and she was like, you know what?
Well, I think like it was like she was ironically because she was defending her friend who was being accused of being a gold digger.
Right.
And she's like, oh, well, you know, this is a gold digger. And then she's like, I actually like the guy.
All right, this works.
It's not that bad.
This musical also premieres the song We're in the Money, mm-hmm. sung by Ginger Rogers. She's wearing a literal dress of coins.
Yep.
The coin dance is song. Very good at the beginning.
That's great. Well, the beginning of the movie.
And also,
like
she is
taking the coins when they get impounded. Like, yeah. They're literally taking coins back.
Yeah, I love they do this giant, giant number. Because this is a Bugsy Berkeley musical. So you have, two or three of these insanely elaborate, beautiful, well choreographed things that are actually impossible to do on stage, but in the world of this movie,
like the camera is like places that it could never be. It's actually really cool.
It's awesome.
It's like an early, it's an early use of cinema. That's like, I mean, around this time you're doing these huge dance stage shows, and this really is like what you can do with film that you can't do on a stage in the sort of closest form to what you do on stage. Just but we can do this, but now we have this like giant three-dimensional thing with stairs, and we're gonna have cameras from every angle, and we're gonna have like
overhead shots.
Yeah. And yeah, it's very cool.
Well, I love that in the Ginger Rogers singing that song, she does have that insane verse, but she does it all in pig Latin and like,
oh my god,
I was like, what is happening?
Yeah,
it took me a minute.
I was like, she's saying this so confidently. Like, what if you didn't know what pig Latin was? What did you think would have happened to your brain?
Oh, she's having a stroke.
Literally, she's saying it so confidently.
It was great.
And it's funny because also at the end of that sequence, they do this entire number, so good, so elaborate. And then the guys come in, oh, you're out of money. And just takes all the costumes. Like, like it's done. Like, you could open this afternoon. Like, this is a completed number.
Nope,
we're
impounded.
Done.
There's a nice, like, balance in this movie of, like, it's, like, it's sort of, like, romanticizing, like, the sort of Broadway image, but also, like, really undercuts it. In certain ways, which it has like a sort of like self-awareness to it that I don't think you necessarily see.
I was thinking the same thing. Like, it has, I thought this movie was mostly fine, but I did really like we sometimes have this sort of romanticized view of the Depression of, like, you know, sort of people, like, you know, that we have to be serious. It's all about people suffering. And there are a lot of movies from this era that are either about the time that they're in or are about other poverty-stricken times that are about how, you know, how sad it is. And then there are a lot of, like, totally glitzy, like, I think some of the other musicals of, like, this variety are more, like, straight glitzy, sort of escapism movies. I like that all of the people in this movie are unabashedly really fucking poor, and their lives really suck unless they can find some way to make a very small amount of money without it being, like, it's dark. Like, it's, like, dark and sort of, like, snarky about the Depression. And I enjoy... It makes me feel very close to these people because I feel like this is the tone we take to our horrible world around us today.
It's very millennial. I was like, ah, yes, so there's five of you living in one apartment.
Right.
You're sharing clothes to go to this job interview.
Right.
You're stealing other people's milk. Are coming over, and you're like, okay, I guess we'll put on a show, and maybe we'll have some money, or else I don't know what we're going to do.
Well, and also, like, they're kind of not gold. It kind of, like, would be better if they really were gold diggers, because then they'd actually have money, but they're not even really that. Like, they're just, like, they're going on dates with guys they kind of like, but, like, mwah.
Yeah, but maybe they get a hat out of it. Like,
well, yeah, it's a comedy.
Yeah, but also let's assume that the show made a ton of money too. So
right,
yeah, it was an elaborate show.
This, I liked this movie a lot. I think possibly it was also because the previous two movies we had watched for a podcast were just real fucking down in the dumps.
They've been sort a little of rough.
Movies. Watched Little Big Man and The Crying Game, and then it was like, here's this spirited Broadway
this
musical.
Is true. It's been
beautiful, like, such witty, they had, like, I was, like, laughing, like, there was, like, some really good zingers, like, the banter between all the women is really funny, the musical numbers are beautiful.
Yeah.
The whole number where they are doing the waltz, where, like, they're playing these, like, neon violins and, like...
Yes! Oh, those were crazy!
That was really
that
cool.
That was so cool.
I, like, didn't
the very
know they
end
had
number
neon.
Was sort of confusing, but, like, I also thought
did.
It was really good. The Forgotten Man thing. Like, I was like, oh, we're doing a tone change. Just very abruptly. But yeah, it was definitely, I feel like it did what it set out to do, which was not to climb Everest, but to just kind of get us over the hill.
Well, yeah, I laughed a lot during this movie. It's just really fun. And it is kind of funny that the movie called Gold Diggers is way more progressive than The Crying Game and Little Big Man. And I think partly it's because it understands, like, the tone so well, and it's going for the kind of, like, populism, we're going to have this kind of celebration of the genre in the midst of the Depression in a way that is, it's earnest, it's good, and it has all the right intentions, and it's funny and clever, and yeah, this is one of the stronger ones of the many, many musicals that were during this time. Like, it's better than the Best Picture winner, Broadway Melody, etc.
It is better than Broadway Melody, I thought the same.
And
I've seen.
Yeah. It was better than Meet Me in St. Louis, like, to be honest.
Yeah, I agree.
I don't know if that's, like,
sure.
A hot take, but,
yeah.
Like,
yeah, no,
Meet Me in St.
Better.
Louis was boring and weird.
It was boring and weird.
And this one also has a great kind of moment in Hollywood history, because this is basically right at the end of the pre-code era.
Oh, yes, it is.
So this
I was going to ask you about that.
Yes, I mean, there's never, like, an official, like, here's the day it started. It all kind of, like, eased out, and this kind of was pushing the boundaries as the boundaries were kind of becoming
right. Like, there's
more
a lot
kind of
sex jokes in this.
Yeah, well, it's actually like a sexy movie. Like,
yeah.
there are these kind of sequences.
Yeah.
But during the big number in the middle, like, there's this whole, like, undressing sequence
right.
and silhouette, and even the dime, the wearing the money outfits.
Yeah,
the little pervy kid was kind of.
Yeah, the pervy kid.
Pervy kid was weird. Like, didn't like it. Austin tried to assure me that it was a little person and not a child, and that made me feel a little better, but I'm not sure.
It would have to be
not.
Like a teenager.
Well, I think it is a little person, a dwarf actor, on the stage playing a child.
Yes, I understand.
Not in the movie. I think in the movie it is a dwarf actor playing a dwarf actor who is on that stage sequence playing a child. I think that's how it worked in the movie.
At one point there was a kid that looked a lot like a kid.
Yeah, like, one of those kids was definitely a child. A
anyway, the scene, it was very sexy. And it was like the kind of sexy where it didn't feel very exploitive, but it was fun.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like, who knew we had it this good in the 30s?
Who knew?
That's true. It was a great time.
Yeah, let's go back to that.
So this was...
I love 1933.
So could anyone
it made a shit ton of money. It made $1,600,000 bucks in 1930s money.
Yeah, I mean, I think musicals did so well in the era because it was something where, like, for the longest time, only if you're in the big cities do you get to see shows like this. Right. And also a lot of people can't afford to go to Broadway shows. And now you're getting, as all across the country, getting to see Broadway-level quality shows. So musicals did really, really well. Similar to how, like, right now all these big superhero movies are doing well because only at the cinema can you see that level of, like, CGI budget for blowing up
cities. Yeah, but you can see it at home now.
Yeah.
Well, it's true. Now it's changing.
They're making a lot of money because it's a bunch of hero stuff.
What's
stupid?
I thought We're in the Money, the song is called Pennies from Heaven. Is that not what it's called?
No. Well, I think Pennies from Heaven is a different thing.
Yeah. What's Pennies from Heaven?
Isn't it? It's a show, too.
I have no idea.
Isn't it a song?
Probably, but I think it's also like a sad movie and miniseries.
Oh.
About the Depression era. So probably a song from there.
Anyway, I didn't realize that song was from this show. I thought it was from something else, and like maybe they had taken it, stolen it.
I always thought it was from 42nd Street, but it at least premiered.
That's what I thought too.
Yeah,
but didn't they do 42nd Street at our high school? Didn't they sing "We're in the Money"?
I skipped that one.
I'm doing research.
But yes,
I did too.
Yeah, our high school did put on 42nd Street our senior year. But at that point, they had
finally an appropriate choice.
It had taken a couple years. But after the Wiz, I'm like, I'm going to wait and see.
I still can't believe that you guys were at one of the white high schools that did the Wiz.
They do. Mm-hmm. They sing We're in the Money in 42nd Street. I'm not a crazy person.
Okay, good. That's where I thought it was. So at least it premiered in Gold Diggers. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't really have...
We're in the money. We're in the money. Old Man Depression, you've come back. Because of student loans.
recession.
You welcome to our house.
Nailed it.
I don't want anyway.
To say about this movie, and I always worry it's a bit of like a genre bias where we think of like things as like lesser genres, like, oh, musicals can't be discussed as well. But like,
that's just false. I think we've debunked that.
I will say though, like, this movie's fun. I don't know that this movie is great. Like, it was fine. I enjoyed it. I don't think I didn't feel like I was amazed by it or totally understand why it needs to be among the 1001 movies that you have to see before you die. I didn't like it all that much, but the dance sequences were cool. I just have it, like, in comparison to so many similar things around it, I don't totally get why this one, but, like, it was fine. I liked it.
I think I would need to look at it, like, in terms of, like, how many musicals are on the list and, like, what this space is taking. Like, what...
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, I think that there is a very good argument to, like, why is this here? And also, it was better than Meet Me in St. Louis.
I mean, yeah, like, no, I mean, look, we've definitely seen a lot of worse movies than this.
What was the first musical that we did? Would it have been New York, New York?
Maybe. New York, New York was a lot of fun. That was a musical that was better than this musical.
What are you talking about?
The one that has New York, New York in it, which is called...
New York, what a wonderful town.
Which is called...
Oh, On the Town.
On the Town, there you go.
Let's see, New York, New York, we didn't watch the sad Scorsese movie.
Nope.
Not yet.
Let's see here. So... I think this book is cheating about what it counts as musicals. But the musicals we have covered on this podcast include...
Do you highlight them as we hit them?
No, it's just... I'm looking... There's an index in the back here of musicals. But we've done... obviously, Gold Diggers 1933. We have done Actually, there's a whole bunch. The Lion King.
Oh, yeah.
That is a musical.
It's a musical.
Meet Me in St. Louis.
It's a musical now, but we're not evaluating the musical. We're evaluating the animated movie.
That's true.
They count Nashville as a musical. I think that's a bit of a cheat.
That's cheap. That's kind of.
Yeah.
That's not a musical. Movie that has a lot of music in it.
Yeah. Obviously, On the Town, and we've done Wizard of Oz. That's a musical.
That's right.
Yeah. And we've done Willy Wonka, which I guess is a musical.
Yeah.
Is it?
I guess it is.
Yeah, it is.
So we still have a bunch left, and also a bunch more on this list that I think is definitely cheating. But yeah.
Nashville is not a musical.
Yeah,
no.
Yeah.
Oh, wait. Oh, the Muppet Movie. They're kind of musical as well.
Yeah,
a musical, and it's lovely.
I don't think I've ever seen the Muppet Movie. I've seen Muppet Treasure Island.
I've seen Muppet Treasure Island.
You should see the Muppet Movie. If you like all the newer ones, you'll love the Muppet Movie. Like, it's really a classic. It's really worth it. And wonderful. And good. And holds up very well. And is good.
It's true. Hopefully our descendants will have the chance to see things like the Muppets. Or perhaps HBO will buy them too and put them behind a paywall.
Okay,
we just can't know.
So wait, I want to debunk this. The whole Sesame Street being renewed by HBO Max is not a big deal. HBO's already been funding Sesame Street for a while now. And what they do is the original episodes air on HBO. And then 3 months later, they air on PBS for free.
Yeah.
So unless like kids care about...
Is that what has been happening?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's why...
It's fine.
Yeah. Like, unless kids care about spoilers... Stay off Twitter, and you're fine.
Sesame Street, right.
So it just renewed the same contract for a few more years. Yeah, HBO is essentially funding Sesame Street for, like, a lot of it, and it's still giving it to PBS for free, or some contract.
I didn't realize it was giving it to PBS
1 month instead of 3 months.
I'm sorry. I made a big joke about HBO, and it was mean, and it was also untrue, and I'm sorry.
Well, HBO will never forgive you.
I will never forgive HBO for several things, so...
There you go.
Probably okay.
That's fair.
Henges.
How many hinges do you give it, JC?
I give it a solid 3.8.
I give it a 4.
Oh, I give this, like, a 3. It's fine. I don't really...
You're the rich guy's brother.
Sorry.
I give it a 4. It's fine.
The musical scenes alone give it a 4. So good.
It's fine.
Well, no, the musical scenes give it, like, a 3.
It's fine.
What? The production of them.
It's fine.
It's great. There's 3 big sets and then a whole bunch of stuff in the middle, which is fun to watch.
Yeah.
It's fine.
Fun banter.
Y'all crazy.
Why are you mad at him? He gave it a 4.
He dismissed the musical scenes.
I didn't dismiss them. I'm saying they account for 75% of the film.
I think you're yelling at him. And I gave it a 3.
3 out of 4 of the film is the musical numbers.
Man.
All right.
Now we have to all watch it again until you all get better ready.
The album this week is Beach Samba. Is a 1967 studio album by Astrud Gilberto, who is super old woman, is a Brazilian samba and bossa nova singer. And she's famous because she is the girl from Ipanema in the most famous performance of the girl from Ipanema.
Yep.
I don't know what that is.
It's
you'd recognize the song.
Yeah.
It's like the elevator song kind of thing, but...
And it's a
very well known.
Yeah, it's sort of like the most well known, probably like bossa nova samba song. And
half
like,
of it's in English. It's a thing.
And it's like about a sexy lady in a bikini. It's like
a guy basically gets struck when he sees this very very beautiful woman in Brazil.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
on the beach of Ipanema.
Is that what we call it these days?
Walk by
Brazil.
Struck, I think, was what JC was referring to.
Like multiply. I mean, it's actually kind of a weird song if you think about it.
It's a weird song, yeah. It's a weird song. But Beach Samba is Astrud Gilberto's, own album. The Girl from Ipanema is not on it. But it's basically, a nice selection of very, easy listening kind of samba and bossa nova songs. I really don't have a lot to say about it. I enjoyed that I felt like it is useful soundtrack music. Like, if I am ever needing a parade tune, I now have a parade tune on my Spotify to play as a sound effect that is nice. But, like, I didn't get a lot more out of it. And other than her being from, you know, the girl from Ipanema, I didn't get a lot of understanding of why this is on the list. So it was a little hard. I enjoyed it. Don't get me wrong. I really did. And it's a good, it's not the first bossa nova album we've done. It's a pretty good example of the style and it's like good. But yeah.
It felt very like the women from Big Little Lies go to a much warmer beach than usual. Like, that's how I could picture those songs being used. You know?
That makes sense to me.
I think it is such a great album for its setting. But since I was not at a beach listening to this, I got angry at the album.
That also makes sense. I was also listening to it on like a very rainy day in Chicago, and it was a little miserable.
Yeah, I was angry.
Which means it made you feel something.
Music that's out of place like that can feel very much like waiting tone music or elevator music, which I think is like the risk of listening to something like this when you're like, oh, it's fucking torrenting rain outside. Like, this sounds like I'm trapped in hell's elevator.
I think it was less to me that it sounded like waiting music and more that I had that feeling that there were people somewhere in the world that were happy and I was not one of them.
That's where I was. It's an album that does not inspire you. It should only be reflective of what you're already into.
Yeah, like,
it doesn't make you happier.
I'm on a very warm beach, maybe I will play this album feel like very
be
loose.
Wonderful.
But I
like it, you have to have a martini in your hand and you need to be barefoot on the sand.
Oh no, like I want like
and
a
then you
Mai
put this on the
I
record
want, like, a
player.
Mai Tai or a pina colada, something sweet, you know.
Okay, that's fair.
And then
you're just sort of like drunkenly swaying.
Yes. This is an album to drunkenly sway to on the beach.
And I listened to it like 2 o'clock on a Chicago rainy afternoon and I got 3 more hours of work. I'm like, fuck this.
I felt very similarly.
In terms of actual music, though, it's nice. It's sweet.
Yeah, it's nice. It's not that I don't.
Is it all in Portuguese?
No. It's mostly like British. It's mostly like American pop tunes.
Damn. All right.
Yeah. Which is like, and like some of it is. There are a couple songs in Portuguese, but mostly it's. And you know, she didn't write her own songs. They're like from all over the place. You know, I like that this list does some world music. I think there have been some really cool things I've found. I wish. It's partially just that I wish that there was more context online for these world music selections, because I often, like, I have such a limited understanding of, like, the world that this album, like, the musical sort of pantheon that this kind of album exists in, that it's really hard for me to evaluate it, but I enjoyed it, except that I mean, it made me hate my life, but I enjoyed the music. Would you like me to give a different henge rating to My Life Last Wednesday and this album? Because I could.
So I was wondering what her relation is to Gilberto being like the world famous guitarist, singer, songwriter, all that stuff. Husband.
Oh, there you go.
So, yep.
Huh. Pretty cool.
3.8.
3.3.
I'll also give it a 3.3.
Perfect.
All right, that is Beach Samba.
Ooh.
Now it's time for the song segment.
Yes.
Very musical episode this week.
Ha! Because we literally opened with a musical.
Was that a joke?
Yeah. It wasn't a joke. It was just like, we got a lot of talk about music and
basically
such.
Any movie that has music heavily will
therefore
beget a musical heavy.
Fuck you, what's the song?
This week we listened to I Walk the Line by Johnny Cash.
I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds. Because you're mine, I walk the line.
Mm-hmm.
I Walk the Line is a song by Johnny Cash. Came out in, or at least recorded in, 56. It is a short song that is very sweet. Basically him avowing his, not avowing, proclaiming, no, pledging. Pledging? Yes. His
promising.
Love, promising his love and faithfulness to his dear sweet wife while he's on the road.
Yeah, well, yeah, it's promising his faithfulness, which it
his
seems
attempt.
It seems is a very huge, like, difficulty for him. Like, he needs to explain that it is because of how much he loves her, like, that he's really gonna try and not sleep with other women. It's not the most romantic song.
No.
I'm sorry that I fucked up, June. I'm really sorry. I'll be better in the future. That's a song.
Gosh, yeah.
Well, it's I'll try real hard not to fuck up, June.
But clearly in the context of I definitely have in the past.
Yeah.
I mean, we've watched Walk the Line.
Right.
The Johnny Cash film, which is about how
I have actually not.
He does not walk the line.
Yes,
and then decides he should walk the line
and writes this song, at least according to the movie, in response to that part of his behavior as exactly what it is—a promise to his real life wife, June Carter.
Oh, was it? Because I think at the time he was with Vivian.
Oh, really?
Yes, at the time he was still married to Vivian.
Okay.
June Carter was 1968.
Okay. Well, then I might remember it.
Didn't they, like, kind of have a thing before he divorced his wife?
Yes, they did.
They, let's see, Vivian, they were married in 54, divorced in 66. So he wrote this for his ex-wife.
Yeah, there's definitely, that, what?
Sorry.
Did the movie blatantly lie, like, that deeply?
I don't know. I haven't seen
it's possible.
Movie.
The movie is definitely a very loose biopic.
I'm Googling it.
I haven't seen it since theaters, so it's, like, 14 years ago, but, like...
I mean, it's not a great movie.
It's fine. Yeah. There's some good performances, but it's
but
fine.
Isn't Walk there... Hard, obviously.
Walk Hard, it's a better movie. But, like...
Walk Hard.
Isn't there kind of overlap of him with... June, while he's with his first wife, though?
Yeah.
I honestly don't know. This song came out in 56, which was like 2 years after he married his first wife. So okay. I don't think they overlapped that deep.
Yeah. But we've heard this song before, because we did a Johnny Cash album not too terribly long ago.
Yeah. We did Live at Folsom Prison.
Yeah.
Was it that prison? Or was it a different prison?
I thought we did San Quentin.
San Quentin.
Which was awesome, and that was
so good.
That was such a cool part because when he did that song, you hear the crowd reaction.
Yeah,
and this is a song that like everyone just like gets into.
It's a great song. Audibly. Well, and Johnny Cash, and it has like there's something about Johnny Cash's voice that is simultaneously like beautiful and croony and like nothing that anyone else can possibly ever do, and also like very relatable. Like he really is. Like, his singing is really magnetic. I love this song. This is one of my favorite songs ever. It's great.
It's awesome. Yeah, it has, like, the catchiest rhythm.
Yeah.
It has great lyrics. Johnny Cash's voice perfectly matches all of that. It's a great combination.
It's probably my second favorite Johnny Cash song after Ring of Fire, which is the best song ever.
But he repeats the chorus... What, three times? And each time he goes, like, up or down two octaves?
Yeah, it's really something. It's great.
Which is a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Like, how low can you go?
Okay, so I've looked at Wikipedia. So Johnny Cash and his first wife are, like, get together. They marry in 54.
Yep.
And he marries June Carter Cash in 68, but he met her 13 years before.
Yeah.
So 13, so like they're 55.
I don't know when they became involved in the carnal embrace sort of situation of things, but they did know each other for a long time.
Yeah. 68 you said they were married?
Yeah.
So it would have been 55. It would have been the year after he married Vivian.
Yeah. They met.
Okay.
And I think she also had been married before, too, which was a big deal because, like, Carter family was, like, they're, like, a Christian singing family.
Maybe he wrote it for June while married to Vivian.
That's what I'm thinking. The
movie told us. So that's why she writes Ring of Fire. A burning ring of fire. It burns, burns, burns.
Walk hard.
Okay. It's a fun song. It's catchy. It's real short.
Yeah.
Really short. Just quick to the point.
Mm-hmm.
I walk the line. Don't know what that line is. It's a little vague, but
it's a metaphor. Hundreds.
I give this a very healthy 4.7 henges.
That was what I was going to do.
4.7. 4.6.
4.6.
All right, that is I Walked the Line by Johnny Cash. Now it's time for the TV show segment where we're going to watch, let's give it its full title, Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom.
Brought to you by Mutual of Omaha?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Wild Kingdom is presented by Mutual of Omaha, the company that pays.
Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom is a nature show that aired from, let's see here, 1963 to 1988. It had a small revival, but we're not talking about that. because I haven't seen it.
Right.
It's supposed to be like shit or anything. We're looking at the actual thing here. This is the thing that was made by Marlon Perkins. Yes, and it's financed by the insurance company Mutual of Omaha.
Which is just, it's like such a 60s thing. Like, it's like, in your parents' house, they have up in one of the bathrooms, one of those like things from, one of those like dialogues about what it means to be a boy that's from like Parade magazine.
Yeah,
and that's
that
sponsored
so
by a
times.
Life insurance company. Like, it's such like a 60s and 70s like housewife era. I don't know. It's just bizarre and very much of its time for an insurance company, for something that boring to get naming rights on like a nature show.
Yeah. And it's YouTube page, which hosts hundreds of these episodes.
It's called Citibank's Planet Earth. Like,
what?
That's my point. Like, we wouldn't.
That's fun.
Like,
well, I mean, that's now just, it's all like football stadiums, right?
Sure, right.
Oh, yeah.
But that's, like, I guess that's my
point. Yeah, Boston has Gillette Stadium, which is honestly the worst.
That's, no, Guaranteed Rate Field is the White Sox field, and I think that's the worst one.
That's terrible.
Pretty bad.
Yeah.
This is a nature program that's hosted by Marlon Perkins and Jim Fowler. Essentially, I've saw a handful of these. They are half-hour episodes that are very much educational in nature. It is these men who are leading a zoo-like program and showing you different animals in their locales, or they're doing back here. Because, in fact, one of them was the Chicago Zoo, that's not too far
from
us.
And one of the guys is the former director of the St. Louis Zoo. Mm-hmm. So, like, he's obviously, like, a... Like, these all seem to be, from what I can tell, like, major sort of, you know, like, zoo nature guys.
Yeah.
Like, they're the real deal. This is really their job. Like, they really do, like, study animals and whatnot.
Yeah, and so you watch them do some sort of topic. You know, watch one about bears in the high country. That was mostly about baby bears. I saw them search for a giant armadillo, and watching them try to bag a giant armadillo was great TV.
Yeah,
because it's a like 100-pound thing. It's insane.
Yeah. I watched them try to tag an echidna, which was very difficult for them to do, and they needed a dog to help them find, like, sniff out the echidna so that they could attack the tracker to it. And it was a lot of like two middle-aged men and a dog wandering around the Australian outback until they finally found a spiny thing and stuck something on it.
Yeah, and they'll have in-studio segments. They'll have a lot mostly kind of out in the field. And
their studio is so cheesy, though. You know what it reminds me of? It reminds me of, because I'm sure that this is an intentional quote for Carmen San Diego, like, it looks like the inside of the like game show space where Carmen Sandiego happens that has the big screen on the TV show, but it is like it's very much like a fake like soundstage like library thing with a big screen on the wall.
Yeah.
And like it's like one of the old dudes who doesn't go in the field. Sometimes there's video of the two men who are in the field, sometimes in peril.
Yeah.
And he comments on it.
And I think that's a kind of it creates the vibe for the show very much, because this is such an educational program in a different kind of way that we have anymore. Because it really is like you'd put this on in front of a classroom, because this is people talking to the camera, teaching you something. So much now of our nature programs, it has a different level of art to it. Something like what the BBC does, it is like we're going to show through kind of beautiful filmmaking what is in the natural environment, and Richard Attenborough will be added later. This really is, it feels like a presentation you would see at a zoo, and it's still super charming in that kind of way, I feel.
It's funny, I would not say that. Obviously the obvious modern comparison point is Planet Earth, and, like, I felt that it actually had a lot of, I mean, the more, nature-y ones. Like, I watched a couple one about baby leopards that was super cute, because you know what are cute? Baby leopards and baby cheetahs. And some other ones were very much like there were even some that I watched that included the sort of like, this is how we get this shot, like this is how we're getting pictures of this, in the same way Planet Earth does. Like, it's very much, I very much got the feeling watching the scenes that were in the wild, like there were a lot of things that were in the zoo, and those were a little bit more like sort of edutainment kind of things, but this was like, there are a lot that do take place, like, in the wild, and those felt very impressive to me for the 1960s and 1970s, and I was really struck by, like, how lucky we are now to have so much in the way of nature photography and documentary, because, this very much feels like when you're watching it, you're like, oh, this has never been filmed before, maybe. Like, this is, like, really cool, and it's obviously not as pretty as Planet Earth, but I felt it's a big range of stuff. Like, and then there's the shark episodes, which we're definitely going to spend a very large portion of this segment talking about, which are weird.
Well, I mean, I guess my comparison point was, like, whereas, like, Planet Earth, Blue Planet kind of go for a National Geographic thing of, like, we are just the observers. This is a program that always has the zoologists on screen. And because, like, Planet Earth, unless, like, you watch scenes after the credits of, like, how they did it kind of thing, they're not on screen. Being nature.
Right.
And this one has, again, people walking around trying to put a giant armadillo in a bag for zoo-like purposes. And it's a very big bag. It's a very big armadillo. And you got to watch them struggle.
Yeah.
With charming...
I want to watch that one. That one sounds delightful.
With charming 60s and 70s kind of voiceover that has the kind of like, oh, he's doing a good job out there. Uh-oh. Looks like something got away. And a very wholesome, made for families and made in my mind, like, what is kind of the great purpose of zoos, that it inspires a younger audience, right?
Yeah. Like, oh, totally.
This, in the same way someone could, like, see a wildcat, like, exhibited at a zoo, this can inspire people who get really into animals and a career in that.
I even heard them, they even made a nod to climate change. Like, straight up, like, it was an episode from the 70s, and it was about snow leopards? We were somewhere, it was cold. Hmm. And they were saying, like, by the way, like, temperatures are getting warmer, we're worried about this, and, like, habitats are melting, and that's not good. And they talked about endangered species, and, like, limited habitats, and things like that. And I was like, look at you!
Hmm. 40 years ago?
Can we talk about the sharks? Can I talk about the sharks,
please? We can talk about the sharks now.
Okay. So, here's the thing. I actually think that you are right about some of the episodes. I think there are... I watched two episodes that absolutely did not have zoologists on screen, except for the beginning and the end, and were very nature documentary with just a voiceover. So I think it's a wide variety of, like, kinds of episodes.
300 episodes, I've seen like 7.
Yeah, so. And I've seen about the same. One of the kinds of episodes is something I would describe as like, let's show off new animal, like new technology or something involving animals. But this was, it's all on YouTube. You can go watch it. And right after I had watched like a perfectly reasonable episode, I think it was the Echidna one. The next one that came on was about sharks. And it was about testing new chainmail wetsuits for divers to wear to protect them from sharks. It just involved two guys with serious mustaches diving into the water and fighting with sharks. Like, that is the best way. Testing out various non-lethal shark repellents, which is basically just fighting with sharks. Like, they had chemical guns, and they had big sticks. They also had a safety cage. I'm doing air quotes because there was a hole in the safety cage that was big enough for a shark to get in, and it got in, and they had to fight it out with their hands. And this whole time I'm watching this, I was like, and then they're like, let's try out these wetsuits, which are just chainmail, like, bodysuits, which first are filled with bait. That's check one. And they are too close to them, and the sharks smell them, which is when they have to fight the shark out of the safety cage. And then they're like, oh good, they didn't rip. Or rather, they tried two different chainmail suits, and were like, well, that one ripped, so I guess we won't use that one. We'll use this one. And then they wear the chainmail and go down and just let the sharks attack them. And while it is true that the sharks do not penetrate the chainmail with their teeth, they like flail these men's limbs around in ways that look extremely painful, and it was clearly an out-of-control situation, because at one point the voiceover goes, and then we interfered, because it looked like things were getting a little too tough to handle, and like, it's when this guy's arm, like, goes the wrong direction, and I'm like, what am I watching?
So I didn't see that episode. I saw a different shark.
Different shark episode.
Well, what can I ask about that episode? Because though all the ones I've seen, even then when a bear is getting too close or the shark is right there, it's still edited and narrated in a very pleasant tone.
Yes.
So is it still like,
yes,
uh-oh, Billy's having a bit of a tough day?
Yes, it was very much that. And it was like, but what you were watching on screen looked more like the movie Roar, that movie that they tried to make that had live lions in it that attacked people. Like, it was definitely, like, not an entirely safe situation, and just not well thought out. Like, I watched a little bit of the second shark one that you watched, and honestly, the things they were doing seemed relatively well thought out. They were trying out a new kind of submersible, some other stuff. The one I watched seemed very ad hoc.
Well, I mean, that still had one moment when the shark opened the top of the underwater cage, and they go, oh, well, the shark accidentally closed it by using his fin. I'm like, yeah. You didn't have a backup plan.
Yeah, there wasn't, like, there was, and it's just funny because, like, it is, like, we just have, I mean, one assumes that the barrier to entry for wandering around in nature in a serious way was a lot higher, and so people who did it because it was a lot more dangerous than what it is now, and so the guys who did this were kind of daredevils and just did this shit. But it's weird. And that episode with those sharks was maybe some of the most fun I've had watching television in a little while. It was a good time. I liked it. I like this show. This show is a very cool little cultural artifact.
It was ultimately a bit dry for me. That's why I didn't end up watching like an absurd number of episodes.
Yeah.
That like, I really did appreciate it. For what it was doing and just the variety of topics it had and things I didn't see and things that were just, you know, really cute. Like, baby bears were very
were big
cute.
They were big on cute things and snakes. There were a lot of snakes and a lot of cute things.
Yeah, first episode is all about dispelling myths about animals, and one of them was snake charming.
Yeah. No, I watched two different ones that basically amounted to cute things fighting snakes. Like, that was like, one was like, was like a like weaselly things, and then the other one was was baby leopards fighting poisonous snakes.
Mongoose?
Yeah, it must have been. The cute things always won, so there was that. Also, there was a bird that that was definitely a zoo shot, like a giant secretary bird just stomping on a snake to kill it and slurping it up like a noodle.
That's
so, like,
so
I said,
weird.
Lots of snakes, lots of cute things. Good show.
I think we kept saying cute animals so often, my dog just walked over.
Hello.
And is now, like, giving me a hug.
And a win.
Shout out to the cute animals.
Who Hell live yeah. in our home.
Henges. I'll give this a 3.8.
I'll give it... that makes sense, but I'm going to give it a 4 for the people fighting the sharks.
So yeah, you can find 300 plus episodes on YouTube. Legally, it is the Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom YouTube page. It's pretty cool. Check it out.
Yeah.
So that's it for episode 175. Yeah. We're going to be back next week with the 734th entries in all these lists.
Jumping way ahead.
And they're the following things.
We're watching Manhunter.
That is the very first Hannibal Lecter film, so directed by Michael Mann. Get excited about that.
The album is Suede by Suede.
The song is 3 Days by Jane's Addiction.
And I hope you like cute animals, because we'll be back next week with Planet Earth.
Oh. I'm so hype.
I am also hype.
Hell yes. So we got our lineup for next week. Until then, you can follow us on Twitter at The Immortals Pod. Check out thearchmore.com for more episodes we've done, including this, Ad Absurdum, and Let's Take 5, other podcasts on the site. Check out other fun stuff there. Leave us a review wherever you listen to podcasts. Help people find our show. Really appreciate it. We still have several more episodes to go before we reach 1,001. Don't worry about it.
It's cool.
We're getting there.
We're doing great.
Hell yeah.
Just chipping away.
Yep.
Wow.
Really sold the show there, Peter.
Yep. We're so interesting.
Can't believe I had you as the head of marketing.
Wait, what? Since when? I don't want that.
Oh, shit. Anyhow.
No Don Draper.
No Don Draper.
Pete Campbell.
I'm Austin.
I'm Sarah.
I'm JC.
And I'm Pedro.
Yay!
We'll see you next time. Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.
See you.